Whenever it might happen, by Brexit, our somehow united European travel market is getting somehow disconnected from one of its fundamentals. According to our figures, in 2019, the British travel industry stands for almost 50 billion British pounds in gross booking, and probably counted in euro, it would have been significantly, essentially more, if the long-time uncertainty about Brexit hasn't have increased a remarkable weakness in pound sterling already. Whether we count in euro or pound, UK is Europe's most digital travel market, at least one of the most digital travel market, with a 67% online share. And this is one of the pretty less things that remain stable for a while, for sure. So what is changing? Let's discuss, and please welcome our panel. Jim Cascard, Director of Policy and Regulation, UK Hospitality. Welcome, Jim. Please welcome Kian Kennedy, he's CTO and Head of Strategy at Holiday Taxis Group. And please welcome Gloria Guevara Manzo, President and CEO of the World Travel and Tourism Council. Welcome, Gloria. Last but not least, we have Mark Tanzer, the CEO of the British Travel Agent Association, APTA. Welcome, Mark. Thanks for joining, guys. And I have to be honest, when we were planning this panel, we had been prepared for whatever, but not for an ongoing uncertainty, which we are trained of for a few years. So the situation remains quite foggy, and we try to bring some orientation to the audience, and hopefully we get success with this. So just a short wrap-up, maybe starting with Mark. What is your most current issue regarding Brexit at the moment? What really drives you?
Good afternoon, everyone. Well, the ongoing uncertainty certainly doesn't help consumer confidence when it comes to booking. And certainly we saw in the run-up to March 29th deadline, people were definitely hesitant to book, and I think we've heard from the, you know, the quoted travel companies that we're seeing a soft summer, and I think that certainly the Brexit effect is one part of that.
How do you prepare for day X? What is the most important task for the hotel industry?
I think thank you, Dick. I think for us at the moment it's around skills and workforce. So I think. Again, as Mark says, the uncertainty is not helpful. We had a challenge anyway with the hospitality sector about sort of perception and recruiting people even before Brexit happened. So we're looking forward to some certainty about how the new sort of visa application system applies going forward. So I think people and skills is a big challenge.
Mm-hmm. We have a real operating company, Holiday Taxis. It's a British company taken over from a Spanish group called Hotelbeds, we all know them,
yes.
Operating in 150 countries. See, and what's most important for you at the moment?
At Holiday Taxis, we're taking a partner-centered approach, looking at our customers and the forward booking patterns we see. A lot of data points that we can assess to look at both the UK source market and in Europe. And we've just been tracking those data points throughout year to date, and in terms of our customers' data within Holiday Taxis, we're not seeing a significant departure from 2018 booking and traveling patterns. It seems to be relatively consistent. I think there's other data sets available for sure, but we just see the data we see. And then on the other side of the partners, we really look at our supply chain. We are in 150 countries and work with about 500 suppliers globally. And key to how we deliver transfers for our partners is to deliver a really good flexible SLA that can deal with either disruption or change. And that's key to how we're preparing for what could come from the Brexit discussions.
Uh-huh. We'll dig into this topic later on, I can tell you.
I'm sure we can.
Gloria, you made a lot of research about Brexit, by the way. Your methodology is completely different to our figures that we release. We're on gross bookings, you're on impact on GDP, so your market is much bigger. I think you have a wonderful 300 billion travel market in the UK counted on GDP impact. So what's essential
on your really global focus for the British travel market at the moment?
That we see. Well, thank you. First of all, thank you for the invitation. Happy to be here. As you know, WTTC, we represent the global private sector. 170 CEOs from around the world are our members. There's a lot of concern about what could happen. And the reason is because we do a lot of research, as you mentioned. We quantify the economic impact in 185 countries around the world. And we know that this is the largest region in the world. However, when you look at growth, is not the one that is growing the most. There's more growth in other regions. So some of our members, 30% are in Europe, 30% in Asia, 30% in America, and 10% in the rest of the world. But a lot of them, they do business in this part of the world. So we're trying to quantify what is the impact in case of a no deal. What happens if there is no deal, right? And we try to explain that in the language that the government would understand, which is jobs. And that's how we were able, based on the assumptions from IMF, the last numbers that they released and the impact on the GDP, that's what we came up with, like 700,000 jobs can be lost in the UK and EU, which means that it's not only a UK problem, it's a European problem. The UK, for us, is the fifth largest market in terms of size of the economy for travel and tourism. And it's a big sourcing market for the rest of Europe. So this is something that we really need to understand what is the impact and do some scenario planning. I know that some of our members are doing that, but as I'm sure Mark will share, we have some concerns still because we don't see what is that end state, where is this going to look, and we see a lot of uncertainty, and that uncertainty is slowing down and it's impacting already the UK market, for instance, in terms of travellers.
I think to to pick that up from Gloria, I think it's slight positive in this is that from the referendum we were out having quantified the value of UK tourism to the European markets and the principal countries that depend so heavily on us, and that is completely understood on both sides that we would suffer if those tourism flows were diminished. And I think evidence of that is that we were probably one of the few sectors that even in the event of a no deal exit, we had contingencies in place. So the flight program for 2019 was guaranteed to continue. There weren't going to be visa controls. So I think that is an indication that both sides understand the value of this. And it's not a zero sum game between us and Europe. I mean, we could both lose in this. And of course, a no deal exit is still a possibility. Having come through the 29th of March, we've still got October the 31st as a potential date for leaving without a deal. So we can't relax. I think it's very important from a consumer confidence point of view that we were able to say to people that even if we were to leave in the short term with no deal, they could still travel through this summer. And if we end up in the same position in October, we'll still have to be able to take the consumers with us on that journey.
Let's stay a bit on figures before we go into the very different challenges you all have. You released some other figures, Gloria. It was minus 700,000 jobs, and it's also
700,000, 400 of those in Europe, and 300 in the UK.
Yeah, exactly. And it is also a decrease in the impact of the GDP. I think it's minus 10.5% up from your calculation, which is huge, I must say. Can you tell us a little bit about this number?
The assumption was from IMF. IMF, yeah. You look at what was the number that they published in Davos and a little bit before, it was a 7% impact just in the UK alone in the GDP. That's counting zero growth minus 7. That's huge. And when you consider that the growth was 3% in average last year, that's how they come up with the 10. That is basically, but it was already say, because of the uncertainty, we're suffering already. I can tell you some of our members, for instance, hotels are having an issue hiring people because of the visas, the lack of uncertainty. Right. People from some parts of Europe that usually move to London, they are not able to hire them currently. Mm-hmm. We're having some issues with the mobility of people. What's going to happen? We're trying to work on biometrics and seamless travel journey and having better processes in airports and people in and out, that's what we're struggling. What is going to happen? Are you going to need a visa to come to the UK? Am I going to need a visa to travel and things like that? When you don't have a clear path, that is very hard to plan for.
Mm-hmm. Gentlemen, some quotes for you. Is this realistic, a minus 10.5% decrease in let's say, GDP impact, which is not gross booking? So will the market, the British market, go down in that high level? What do you say, Jim?
I don't believe it will. I think there'll be some short-term disruptions and adjustments. Issues such as, there's a posted workers directive, so at the moment in the UK you can post workers into the EU, and of course the travel industry depends upon the ability to move, key workers to support tourists. And if we didn't have those freedoms, there'd be restrictions. There could be potentially delays at borders where you have to do intention checks, why are you coming to Spain in the middle of summer, as if you need to ask. That could be a drag in the short term, but I do fundamentally believe that both sides have so much to lose that they will find an accommodation that will minimize the GDP impact of Brexit in the medium term.
Right. Mm-hmm. One of the factors that the IMF, because again, that's their number, we're just following their number, was the single market for airspace, right? The fact that it's open skies right now, you have airlines from the based in the UK traveling within Europe, in the case of a no deal, that wouldn't happen. I mean, I don't know what is the implication and the impact there. You have several airlines that might be impacted as well, and of course they are planning for that. And on top of that, you have the tour operators like TUI, Thomas Cook, and some others that are concerned as well.
And of course, we're seeing a few airlines switching over to Central Europe instead of UK. The operations, so this is of course a huge impact. How about the hotel industry? What are your expectations for 2019 and later on?
Well, I think for us, as the sort of trade association representing the sort of wider hospitality sector, so obviously we represent hotels, but wider hospitality as well. I think for us, there is uncertainty, but it's about working as closely with the various government departments that are sort of dealing with Brexit on a range of levels as we are at the moment. And trying to get, as I say, some of this certainty around what is the future sort of recruitment and visa system going to look like for the hospitality sector. Mm. So, we'll continue those discussions.
Mm. You said, you announced once, Jim, or your association announced that the Brexit is the most important thing ever at the moment, and it has to stop other tasks for a while. So what's leaving at the moment? So when all the industry is focused on Brexit, like it seems to be.
Yeah, and very true, Dirk. And again, we that is our number one priority, and we're looking at it. But what's interesting about sort of the domestic UK agenda in terms of sort of policy work, that's going on almost business as usual. So we're dealing with a range of different consultations at the moment around sort of food and allergens, various other sort of issues related to the accommodation industry. And we've got to sort of deal with those at the same time as dealing with this sort of background uncertainty around Brexit. And we have asked for, we did ask for a delay in some of these consultations and for the UK government to sort of balance out that the industry is dealing with a lot of pressures at the moment, Brexit foremost, but at the same time we're dealing with a range of other domestic issues.
Mm-hmm. Will there come a real service gap just because you don't have enough service craft from other European countries anymore? Do you expect this?
I think it depends on what we end up with.
Talk about a no-deal Brexit here.
Potentially, that could be an issue, but as Mark says, we just don't know at the moment what it's going to look like.
Sure.
But we're trying to do our best to negotiate something that's going to work for everybody.
Mm-hmm. On the other hand, when we talk about the currency, I think the decrease in pound sterling is not that bad for the incoming industry, isn't it? Are you one of the winners in this development?
I hate to keep saying it, but I don't have an answer. Potentially, yes, you've got this this idea of staycation, so potentially people could stay more at home, and again, businesses are certainly sort of looking to maximise that, but at the moment we just don't know.
Yeah. Okay, and how about you? Are you a winner about a weak pound sterling, or are you a loser? I really don't know.
Yeah, I suppose when we're looking at sterling and any changes that may come in, say, coming months in 2019, you almost have to look back to the referendum decision of 17, and there's been a little bit of a ride in terms of currency from there. Our business model is risk-averse in terms of managing currency risk. As we sell our transfers, we will hedge and forward purchase the transfers at cost from our suppliers. So we're able to do that to honor the prices we offer to our partners. Our customers are still booking years in advance. We're taking 2020 and possibly even 2021 bookings as well at the moment for transfers. Partners are opening up forward travel windows as well. So we have to try to provide the certainty to our partners, and pricing is one of the key elements, I think, that we can take care of for partners.
From the floor here.
Hello, I'm Sarah Dwag. I'm a journalist for Hospitality Insight based in Germany. Quick question for you, Jim. What is your contingency plans or actually advice that you give your members regarding labor? Labor shortage is a big problem in the hospitality industry already, knowing that many European citizens could potentially be out of the UK or encounter like more problems staying within the UK. What are your ideas? What are you suggesting to your members about that?
So again, yeah, it's just giving members sort of clear and definitive information about what we know at the moment. So in terms of the settled status, about the fee that's been waived for that, and about giving reassurance to workers, EU workers who are already in the industry, that, you know, this is the situation and this is clear. We're making a case to government on a daily basis that EU workers are, you know, really important for the industry, and therefore any new visa system that comes in post 31st of October has to make accommodations for that, and it has to, you know, basically allow the hospitality industry to sort of carry on as it is. So that's sort of what we're up to at the moment.
Mm-hmm. Mark, we already talked about the airline industry. You said you're safe in 2019 regarding single European sky. And how about the future? Is there a high risk that the UK really loses its flight connection?
Well, it is a risk. If we, you know, we have those rights by virtue of being part of the European Open Skies Agreement, and if we're not in the EU, we have to renegotiate that basis. And there's no doubt that that agreement has opened up a lot of destinations that previously weren't viable, to fly to from the UK. But I come back to, you know, to the point that, those destinations have come to depend upon UK tourists as well. So it's not in their interest to lose that access. I think maybe more problematic is where UK airlines have intra-European flying rights. So a UK carrier is flying from Munich to Madrid, where obviously the whole competitive dynamic is different, and you can see that other European airlines would take advantage of our not being in open skies to potentially squeeze UK carriers out. But from a tourism perspective, our main business is flying point to point, you know, off the UK as an island and to another place. That, as I said, has been agreed to carry on for 2019, even in the event of a no-deal scenario. So I think that is a signal that, whatever the longer-term arrangements are, people want to maintain access. And of course, it's bilateral. You know, Europeans want to fly to London, they want to connect through London to go to New York, and so on and so forth. So I don't think it would benefit anybody to have a kind of closing down of that access. But I'm not complacent. You know, it's one of the issues, access. You know, when we first looked at the impacts potentially of leaving the EU, access, not just aviation, but rail, coach, bus, was clearly one of the most important things, because, you know, we've all benefited from being part of a single European structure in terms of the growth of tourism. And, physical access is, for an island, a very important part of that.
Mm. By the way, it's not only a British topic. We everywhere in Europe we see a decrease in competition, at least the charter flights. A few airlines are gone, Monarch, Air Berlin, a few more, BMI. So what is this doing with the tour operator market and with the flight market?
Well, I mean, it's out there publicly. There's overcapacity in the short haul aviation market, and people have been talking about that for a long time. And even if the passengers are there, the margins are quite low. So it's you know, the aviation specialists, and I'm not one, who have talked about the need for European consolidation for quite a long time, in the same way that the US market has consolidated down to a small number of large carriers. And I think the pressures are the same. You know, you've got relatively high fixed cost in running an airline, and it's always going to benefit in purchasing economies, aviation fuel, and so forth. It's going to benefit larger players.
Mm-hmm. So, do you expect a further consolidation in the European airline market? Have you any research on this or any idea?
That's a good question for the aviation experts, as you say. It's an interesting dynamic because when you look at the numbers from IATA, for instance, last year, they broke a record, a new record. 4.4 billion people flew around the world. 1 billion happened in Europe. That's a lot. It's much more, of course, than in some other regions of the world. So the growth has been very impressive, and the cost has been reduced, which allow a lot of more travelers. And then when you look at the forecast that they are anticipating, the from 4 is going to grow to 8.2 billion in the next 12 years. That's even more impressive. So our sector is going to continue growing. Now, is that to a consolidation or not? I don't know. At the end of the day, it depends of the offer and the demand and the consumer and having choices and having options to be able to travel more and a competitive cost. So it's very hard for us to predict that there will be consolidation. What I can tell you is that based on the growth that we see, that we keep getting from all the players, from IATA, from the airlines, the airports, UNWTO, and even from us, that right now is 1 in 10 jobs, the contribution for travel and tourism is 10% of the GDP, and that's going to grow to 11. But bottom line is that if we don't grow, also, if our sector doesn't grow, if travel and tourism doesn't grow for whatever reason, we're going to impact a lot of the jobs of the future. Because when you look at all the jobs, for instance, that were created last year in the planet, and the year before, and the last 5 years, 1 in 5 were in travel and tourism, 1 in 5. And that's when we're talking about like 47% of the jobs that we know right now, according to research from Oxford, they are gonna disappear or be automated. So we have a big responsibility there to say, oh, hey, how do we capitalize on that growth and make that happen? Because that means a lot of opportunities are on the stake, no? So I don't know what's going to happen in terms of consolidation. What I know that this is a sector that is providing a lot of hope and a lot of opportunities, but we need to get it right. Right. And we need to be ahead.
And as you said, there's not only impact on the UK market, it's a European impact, so to say.
To me, this is a European issue. It's a global issue. And it's the way that we see it, this is another crisis, if you will. And crises every day impact our sector. Different type of crisis, right? It could be an outbreak today. It could be a terrorism attack, unfortunately, tomorrow. It could be a natural disaster. This is a political crisis we're facing with Brexit, if you want to call it like that. I don't know if that's the right definition. We need to learn from the crisis and plan for those, try to minimize the more that we can do, right? Manage them. But we know as we monitor all these crises from around the world that the geopolitical or political instability are the ones that are impacting the most our sector. So we are seeing already the impact in case of Brexit because the region is not growing at the same pace that other regions like Asia, for instance, and others. And the UK, when you look at the growth, and I'm talking about the GDP for travel and tourism, 2017, it was 4.6. Last year, it was 1.4. That was a huge decline. Now, the pound, as you say before, down is helping. And of course, it's a beautiful product and a lot of travelers going. I'm sure that Mark knows he's the best, the UK. But also, the UK is a great sourcing market, right? A lot of people from the UK are coming to this part of the world. And we have seen also a little decline in this part of the world.
Let's stay on this macroeconomic focus. I found a nice quote from Peter Long, who has been CEO of TUI Travel for a while, and he made this quote, I think it was 3 years ago, he said, the nowadays TUI group wouldn't exist without the European Union. He said, we wouldn't have created a pan-European company if there had not been one Europe. The complexities of two cross-border mergers would not have been happened, he said.
I agree.
There are a lot of pan-European companies. TUI is one of them. a few more. So has this a global impact on further investment and on further mergers? What do you think? Don't know who wants to start, but maybe Mark is an expert in this.
Or I hate the word product, you know, the product of moving people across is obviously an international business. Actually, it's less integrated on a European level than some other industries, really, in terms of, you know, the ability to manage supply chains and so forth. It's not like a manufacturing business. You know, having a hotel in your supply chain is quite different to trying to move physical parts to make a machine in the UK. So I think in that sense, we've probably got more flexibility than some other industries. And also, you know, unless you choose to buy an airline, to own an airline, it hasn't got huge capital investment, you know, so again, you've got flexibility there. So I think, you know, we will be able to adjust to whatever the, you know, the political outcome of all of this is, certainly from a UK perspective. There may be players who at the moment are, you know, TUI maybe one who are really European, but the majority of our members who account for most of the travel are sort of UK-based organizations with European suppliers. Mm-hmm.
And by the way, we have a great example that a pan-European merger is still possible. Solid Tax is getting integrated in a hotel beds group.
Sure.
So everything's fine, Kian, with that?
Sure, and I suppose wearing my IT hat, and speaking for Holiday Taxis, of course,
sure.
In this scenario, sure. There's a lot to do. We're 100 days into our new partnership and new family working within beyond the beds, at hotel beds. And I think our focus, and maybe this is just in the context of a Brexit backdrop, but our focus has been really working on sourcing and product. Beyond the Bev have a very strong product and almost equivalent size business to taxis. And we're helping bring, I suppose, specialist focus to the ground transportation product as part of this exercise, and bringing two sourcing teams together, and that's really been the focus for I suppose first 100 days. And I think in context of Brexit, then wherever it goes, there's huge uncertainty, or there is uncertainty, perhaps not huge. Preparedness is important for a business like ours. Flexibility is important. Responding to customer needs are important, and what we're doing isn't in the context of Brexit, but it supports our ability to react to uncertainty and to address these issues. So I think putting the two product and sourcing teams together to deliver the most cost-effective quality product is probably a useful task to be doing in the context of maybe where we're going over the next 3 or 4 months and working up to October 31st.
Dirk, could I just ask a question? Sorry. From my perspective, I'm German. I have dual nationality with the UK for 2 days now, gloriously.
Congrats.
Thank you. I wonder, in your opinion, do you see Brexit happening?
There you go, Dirk.
He wants to say that.
It's a fair question, isn't it?
it's a fair question. Again, going back to this, what everyone's touched on, the uncertainty. What we've got to do at the moment is just work to the deadlines that have been outlined by the government, which is 31st of October. And again, from us as a trade association, our sort of main aim at the moment is trying to get as much clarity as possible from government about what's going on and feeding that back to our members.
Your personal opinion, your personal thought, where we're heading?
My personal view about whether...
Remove your hat, right. Is that going to happen? What do you think? That's a good question.
I don't know is the answer. All I can say, we've got the timetable that's been outlined. And
what do you think, Mark?
You go first.
You know, it's interesting because if you look at the polls, and you guys know it the best because I was not in the UK when that happened, they say that it was, 57-43 or something like that? It was like 50-50, right?
48-52,
thank you. And someone was telling me just recently, I think it was last week, that the number now is the opposite, but it's the same, right? So like the people to stay now is 52-48 to leave. So we have a referendum, but the right people go to vote, right? That'll be the case. But if the right people, they don't vote, that's something that happened I heard last time, I don't know what is the case, we might leave. From an outsider perspective that lives in London, I think that we will leave. That's my opinion, what I see. I don't know, and that's just not WTTC's opinion, it's my personal opinion. I think that we will leave because now it's just also about saving face, and I don't know if that's the right expression, yeah. But I think after what we went through, it's a little bit about that. That perhaps just me. I don't know, Mark, now what do you think?
I think I agree with you, Gloria. I think it's hard to see this House of Commons not leaving. If there's a new election and new people come in and new ministers who haven't got the political baggage, then it could be different. But I think apart from that, I think they will take us out one way or the other, for good or bad.
Do you also have an opinion, Kian?
I personal opinion, of course.
Of course.
I do. I mean, I think there's a strong support for the referendum decision still. You can see it being referenced in all the media from today. And I think there was three possibilities set out in today's statement from Downing Street, and it was no deal, Brexit, or vote for my deal. Yeah, and I think there's a significant interest in maintaining the dialogue. There's a lot of vested perspective in what's gone in. These aren't accidental. We're not here accidentally. There's a lot of people trying something. So I think one of those three options could definitely
happen.
What
you say is very important because last time was yes or no, right? Leaving or something like that.
Yes.
But if they have three questions, they'll break and divide, says no deal and leave, deal, right, or stay. And then you divide the three options, and I think it's not going to be 50-50. That's the key. If they can get this through, it's going to be interesting. We'll see.
Uncertainty remains. Usually we should talk, when we talk about Europe, we should talk about regulation, about PSD, about GDPR, about Package Travel Directive. I make it short. Any significant changes expected within the UK in all this field of regulations, or will it remain for a while like it is? Consumer protection, I forgot.
Well, with package travel, we're doing some work at the moment just to clarify some of the guidance around it with the UK government. So PSD being Payment Services Directive, is that coming in?
PSD2.
So again, we're working quite closely with UK government and other interested parties on that. So that, as expected, is going to come in.
Derek? Sorry, we do have another floor question, please.
Mm-hmm. Okay, wherever you are, there you are.
Yeah. I'm right here. So we've heard a lot about challenges and uncertainty. So can you talk about the positive effects that might come to the global travel industry if you do exit the EU?
Are there any?
Well, I think there are two sort of short-term impacts. I think actually looking at what you would do in the event of, with your business, if we left, has forced some people to find some efficiencies and to really look hard at their own productivity. And I know we have members who said we wouldn't have done that unless we've been forced to look at our business hard, whether it's consolidating businesses, moving to different places. So there's a bit of short-term gain there. I think if it does genuinely open the eyes of British people to the fact that we need to look beyond Europe in terms of our markets and our exports and our business relationships, then that will benefit tourism. And I don't think personally that those markets will outweigh the European one, at least not in the short term, but they it won't hurt to go and explore.
One more positive fact on Brexit?
Just keep preparing.
Okay, so uncertainty is going on. Thanks, Jim.
Life is uncertain.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Gloria, Mark, it was a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, cheers.